DMA lecture. My name is Timothy Feerst, and tonight I will be discussing with you a motivic analysis and performance practices for Akrodha by Kevin Volans, with comparative analyses of Dr. Volans' other multiple percussion works, She Who Sleeps with a Small Blanket, and Asanga. The purpose of this study is to present a clear and concise motivic analysis of Akrodha, a multiple percussion solo in two movements, based on the motivic content and subsequent iterations. These are written within the tempos and tempo relationships that provide the structural form of the piece. The structural tempos are supported by the presence of various motifs that serve as the tempo's characteristic traits, thereby giving the tempos more tangibility. As the work develops, these motifs reappear either as note-for-note reiterations or as variations that still maintain the unique qualities of the motifs. The study also included comparative analyses of Dr. Volans' other multiple percussion solos, She Who Sleeps with a Small Blanket, and Asanga, which present further explorations into Dr. Volans' use of motifs as they relate to their respective structural tempos. These analyses further cement Akrodha's analytical findings. Lastly, a performance practice synthesis of Akrodha is included. Topics discussed in this performance practice include instrument selection, instrument setup, implement suggestions, universal performance considerations, and executions of certain passages in the music. The information presented was primarily obtained via interviews from individuals involved in the piece's development and early performances. These include Dr. Volans himself, Robin Schakowsky, for whom She Who Sleeps with a Small Blanket and Asanga were written, and Johnny Axelson, for whom Akrodha was written. Additionally, my own personal experiences with practicing and performing Akrodha are included. The goal of this study is to provide a better understanding of the musical content and performance logistics as a means to support a more substantive and meaningful performance. I chose to focus on Akrodha for this study because the prior academic knowledge of this work is minimal. Akrodha has a comparatively larger instrument setup than either She Who Sleeps with a Small Blanket or Asanga. A prospective performer, we need a total of 28 different instruments to perform both movements. Furthermore, close to 30 minutes is required to completely perform the work. These are possible reasons as to why She Who Sleeps and Asanga are more frequently cited in recent repertoire lists than Akrodha. Because of this state of knowledge, a musical analysis and performance practice of Akrodha is necessary for a truly optimal performance of the work. However, certain musical and performance-based knowledge gained from this study can also be applied to She Who Sleeps or Asanga. As Volans said that his approach to writing for percussion has remained relatively unchanged from She Who Sleeps to Asanga and to Akrodha. According to Volans, much of the scholarly information that has been written about him is inaccurate. For that reason, I turned to Volans himself to provide his biographical information. This information was obtained through interview and subsequent email communications, which are documented. Born in Pietermaritzburg, South Africa, on July 26, 1949, Kevin Volans studied at the University of Witwatersrand, Johannesburg, and the University of Aberdeen in Europe. Beginning in 1973, Volans studied under Karl-Heinz Stockhausen and later became his teaching assistant, a position he served for 9 years. Additionally, he studied piano with Alois Kantarski, musical theater with Mauricio Kegel, and electronic music under Hans-Ulrich Humpert. In 1981, Volans returned to South Africa and taught composition at the University of Natal. He was awarded a Doctor of Music from the institution in 1985. After leaving his post at the University of Natal, he resumed his career as freelance composer basing himself from 1986, in the Republic of Ireland. He also held temporary posts as composer in residence at Queen's University Belfast from 1986 to 1989, and visiting scholar at Princeton University in 1992. Volans currently lives in Kinsale, Ireland, after becoming an Irish citizen in 1994. Kevin Volans was a significant member of a group of younger generation composers based in Cologne, Germany. This group of composers included Clarence Barlow, Claude Vivier, and Walter Zimmermann, who were associates of Volans. By the mid-1970s, a few of these composers were tired of the historicist restrictions of so-called new music and the ideas that came out of serial composition. According to Volans, our taste was wider than this. Volans began to rebel against compositional rules set forth by his teachers and set out to create a form of new music that was not reminiscent of the dogmatism of serialism, while at the same time not emulating the bland pursuit of predictability found in minimalism. Volans and his contemporaries sought to write music unmediated by complex pre-compositional planning and had a more direct relationship between their creative impulse and its musical expression. This movement, known as New Simplicity, or New Einfachheit, was short-lived and over by the 1970s. She Who Sleeps with a Small Blanket was written in 1985, initially as part of a series of pieces that Volans called African Paraphrases. In this series, Volans intended to write a set of pieces that began with almost traditional African music and moved away from that, becoming more original composition and less African. She Who Sleeps with a Small Blanket, which was near the end of this series, had little or nothing to do with African music, and only the title is African. Later, however, in about 1985, he dropped the title African Paraphrases as he felt that it suggested an approach that was too Germanic and inconsistent with the very nature of the music he was interested in. Volans' overt references to African music trail off around the end of the 1980s, although the lessons he learned from African composition techniques are to be found in much of his work from then on. With regard to the patterning of She Who Sleeps with a Small Blanket and all of his later solo percussion works, the initial impetus is to be found not in African music, but in African textiles, shua weavings in particular, an example of which is shown on the slide. From this point forward, Volans favored writing music with non-referential material. Asanga and Akrodha, Volans' multiple percussion pieces that follow She Who Sleeps with a Small Blanket, reflect this approach. I would like to talk about my motivic analysis of Akrodha. Akrodha for solo percussion was written in 1998 for Swedish virtuoso percussionist Johnny Axelsson as a result of a commissioning by the Swedish Concert Institute and with financial support from the Swedish radio. Mr. Axelsson gave the premiere performance of Akrodha on March 18, 1999 at the Stockholm Music Festival. Much of Akrodha's material can be traced back to Volans' 1996 work, 5-4, for solo percussion and tape. The tape part of the piece is a percussion part that must be pre-recorded prior to the performance, or that can be played live by another percussionist. The piece was initially written for the purposes of accompanying a choreographed dance. Because of this, Volans writes that he considers 5-4 more of a dance piece rather than a solo percussion part. I began analyzing the motivic content of Akrodha for the purposes of establishing a semblance of structure, for I believe that it was the motifs themselves that determined the structure, much in the way themes and ideas make up structure and form in more classical compositions. After all, these motifs usually reappear either as note-for-note reiterations or as variations. However, in In my communications with Dr. Volans, he informed me that my findings were slightly off base. While it is tempting to look to the motivic content alone to provide a semblance of structure in Akrodha, Volans instead says that the work's tempos and subsequent tempo relationships directly determine its formal structure. To quote Volans, "The tempos and tempo relationships of the piece," meaning solo percussion works, "are crucial, as are the accents or lack of accents. If you play the piece at the wrong tempo, you are playing it in the wrong key." Volans urges researchers to his music to see it as a coming out of the next generation of European composers after Boulez, Stockhausen, Xenakis, etc., with a strong influence of Morton Feldman. As an aside, even Feldman made extensive use of recurring elements. Armed with this new information, I set out with the same mission of analyzing the motivic content of Akrodha, but within a new paradigm of seeing the motifs as unique characteristics of the structure established through the tempos, rather than the governing body of the structure. In the interest of time, I will present select findings from my motivic analysis of Akrodha's two movements. Part one, written for drums, contains the structural tempos displayed here. The graphic on this slide and the next show the flow of structural tempos in Akrodha. It goes from 126 to 120 to 126 to 144 to 100 to 144 back to 100 and then to 144 back to 100 to 126 to 144 to 120 to 168 back to 144 to 168 again to 126 to 100 and lastly to 126. Mr. Axelson describes part one as complex and having longer sections and more stretched out curves of energy. Furthermore, he points out that there are also longer sections that stay in the same mode, but generally the movement moves from a lower to a more static energy to a very high energy, as evidenced by the data on the chart seen here. This is what the overall form, based on the structural tempos, looks like. For one example, the beginning section of the first appearance of tempo A, 126 beats per minute, occurs in measures 1 through 65. Here, Volans presents three primary motifs and two secondary or supporting motifs that add extra color, punctuation, and coherence. The primary motifs are displayed here in this slide. The first primary motif debuts in measure 1 as melodic quarter notes in the upper staff with occasional ornamentations. The second primary motif makes its first appearance in the form of melodic quarter notes in the upper staff, but this time it's 11 over 5 ratio rather than regular quarter notes. But it also has occasional ornamentations similar to the first primary motif. The third primary motif, appearing first in measure 17, depicts rhythmic figures consisting of 2/16th notes and 1/4 note in the upper staff. As the movement progresses, the motif becomes rhythmically syncopated. The two secondary motifs are displayed here. Appearing in measure 4, one motif is in the form of bass drum hits that fill in the space of upper staff content, as well as provide periodic rhythmical accompaniment. Measures 17 and 18, shown here, are an example of how the bass drums interact with the third primary motif. A second motif consists of 1/4 note and 2/2 notes that have occasional ornamentation. These secondary motifs mainly serve, again, as punctuation or transitions between other motifs. Here is an example of how the primary and secondary motifs of the first part of tempo A interact. Some measures are reiterated and some are varied, either in pitch or in rhythm. However, the character of each of these motifs remains intact throughout their development. Though the motifs are isolated at first, they then interact with each other in close proximity. Let's look now at the motivic content in tempo C. This is a primary example of another particularly content that consists of patterned material. Tempo C is identified, as a reminder, at 144 beats per minute and contains a sequential series of 16th note patterns that first appear in measures 162 through 177. Displayed here is the last five measures of that sequence. The importance of order in these measures is noticeable, as instances of full note-for-note reiterations of the sequence occur in measures 267 through 282 and measures 328 through 343. The only differences between these reiterations and the original source are the implements, felt, wood, or otherwise, used to perform them. In measures 189 through 197, the first appearance in tempo C, Volans takes select measures from the original motivic iteration. In this particular case, measures 168, 172, 173, 174, and 175. And then he recombines them to create a new sequence, and then writes four measures of new 16th note patterns that include interplay with the bass drum. The result is a new permutation of tempo C motivic patterns with additional development through the presence of new material. Measures 361 through 367 are prime examples of multiple simultaneously occurring techniques with regards to the sequencing and juxtaposition of multiple motifs. These measures display an interaction between two motifs of tempo E, which is 168 beats per minute, and a segment of the now familiar 16th note patterns of tempo C, which, as a reminder, is 144 beats per minute. First of all, it can be seen that there is a sudden shift in tempo from tempo E to tempo C. All shifts from one tempo to another within part one and part two of Akrodha are sudden, with no accelerandos or retardandos to assist in the shifting. Each tempo change is instant. Secondly, I ask you to take a look at two of tempo E's overall motivic content on display here. The first are the 8 dotted quarter note double stop figures in the upper staff, and the second is a continuous quarter dotted quarter rhythmic ostinato in the bass drum staff. If you will notice, Volans continues the same bass drum ostinato, albeit with different pitches, into tempo C. So therefore, the tempo E ostinato becomes a part of tempo C and acts contrapuntal to the 16th note patterns. Let's now look at part two. The tempos and tempo relationships are listed here. Here is the flow of tempos within part two. Notice that they are more static as compared to part one. It goes from 96 to 80 to 96 and then 96 again. Volans takes a more micro approach to the reappearance of motivic content within the structural tempos. Rather than reappearing complete sections of motifs similar to part one, he instead focuses on reappearances of individual measures. In fact, no more than four sequential measures of the score reappear at a time, which in of itself is a rare occurrence in this movement. Because of this, over 40 individual motifs appear in part two, an exponential increase in the number of motifs from part one to part two. However, certain motifs do appear more frequently than others in the form of reiterations, transpositions, variations, and so forth. A given cluster's rhythmic content and intervallic relationships among the notes presented are crucial traits when identifying and describing one of part two's motifs. Moreover, these traits help in determining whether a rhythmic cluster is a new motif or a type of reappearance of a motif previously seen in the score. Therefore, the identification and explanation of motivic content must be done using musical set theory and analytical techniques. Furthermore, Volans treats the line material and suspended material, two simultaneously occurring staffs, but as separate entities. As the movement progresses, Volans will present material from a given measure's line or suspended staff, but with without the contrapuntal material with which it was paired in its first appearance. As part of this motivic analysis for part two, I conducted a frequency analysis to tabulate and determine how often or not often the motifs appeared and reappeared. The results are displayed on this pie chart. For reference, motifs are identified through the assigning of a letter and number combination pertaining to the staff and measure number in which the material is located. The letter L will indicate that the materials appear in the lion's staff, while the letter S will indicate that it appears in the suspended staff. Consequently, the number assigned with the letter will indicate the material's measure number location. For example, L2, meaning measure 2 of the lion's staff, reappears 18 times. L51 reappears 8 times. L36, L38, and L42 each reappear 7 times. S45 reappears 6 times. And all other motifs reappear less than or equal to 4 times, or not at all. But all motifs that I mentioned in my frequency analysis are presented once, at least once, in the score. For example, let's look at how Volans treats a motif in part two. L2, the most frequently reappearing motif, is characterized as a rhythmic cluster of 4 dotted eighth notes that contain the following intervallic vector of descending a fifth, ascending a third, and then ascending a fifth again. S2 through 3 is an immediate lower third transposition of L2. Although no grace note is present, the intervallic vector remains the same, only it is transposed down a third. S4 through 5 is a rhythmic variation of S2 through 3 because it uses double dotted eighth notes instead. So, when compared to L2, that would make S4 through 5 a very lower third transposition. L5 is a simple rhythmic variation of L2, again, because it uses double dotted eighth notes instead of single dotted eighth notes. Lastly, S6 through 7 is a reiteration of S2 through 3, which therefore makes it another lower third transposition when compared to L2. Compared to part one of Akrodha, part two demonstrates a more fluid approach to motivic content. Additionally, part two's motifs operate more independently to the structural tempos, as reappearances of motifs are not limited to a specific structural tempo. The increased number and variety of the motifs create a landscape that is less directional and more spontaneous. It is clear that there are characteristics that distinguish each structural tempo. However, evidenced by the appearances and reappearances of the motifs, Part 2's motivic content as a whole does not appear to influence the movement's structure and vice versa. Overall, this motivic independence from the structural tempos, as well as the relatively small difference in beats per minute between Part 2's 96 beats per minute and 80 beats per minute, contributes to a structure of being more static, staying more or less in the same expression all the time. Through this, Volans demonstrates that he is a post-serialist composer. For in post-serialism, musical factors such as tempo determine structure rather than individual themes or motifs. Let's look next at how Akrodha compares to She Who Sleeps with a Small Blanket and Asanga from the perspective of motivic content. Kevin Volans wrote She Who Sleeps with a Small Blanket in 1985 for the virtuoso percussionist Robin Schakowsky. Ms. Schakowsky first performed the piece in Salzburg on October 22, 1985. She Who Sleeps is scored for 2 pairs of bongos, 1 conga, 1 tumba, 1 bass drum with foot pedal, and 1 low A marimba. In his composer's note, Volans writes, "I decided to make it," meaning She Who Sleeps, "a composition study for myself by limiting the instrumentation to drums only, with a brief coda on marimba. Volans wrote She Who Sleeps as a virtuoso etude. An etude, as defined by Oxford Music Online, is a short piece restricted to the exploitation of one kind of passage. In other words, etudes focus on a particular technique or idea as the basis of its structural content. However, at a total duration of about 16 minutes, She Who Sleeps is by no means a short piece. In fact, this piece has multiple independent ideas and techniques, as though this etude were actually a collection of smaller etudes. Furthermore, many of these independent ideas, or in this case, motifs, occur within the same written tempo. She Who Sleeps with a Small Blanket contains the following structural tempos. In my analysis, I separated the different appearances of structural tempos because I saw that the motivic content in each appearance was too different from one another. This graphic on this slide and the next show the flow of tempos in She Who Sleeps with a Small Blanket. Starts at 240, then to 160, to 240 briefly, to 160, then 144, then 240 again, 160, then 240, 180, 240 again, 180 again, 160, and finally a range of 160 to 180 beats per minute, which is the coda marimba section mentioned earlier. Compared to Akrodha, She Who Sleeps contains the temporal form seen here. There are instances of juxtaposition of different structural tempos in close proximity that can be found similarly in part one of Akrodha. However, direct reappearances of motivic content occur at very select moments. This makes She Who Sleeps with a Small Blanket somewhat of a more through-composed piece. The emotional result is an intensity curve jumping in between high and low energy, yet it creates an overall general curve of energy going from very high to low energy, to quote Johnny Axelson. Compared to Akrodha, She Who Sleeps with a Small Blanket favors creating new material over precisely reappearing previously stated motifs as it progresses. Let's now talk about Asanga. In 1997, Volans wrote his second multiple percussion solo, Asanga. Like She Who Sleeps with a Small Blanket, Asanga was written for Robin Schakowsky. Volans composed the piece as a gift to Ms. Schakowsky on the passing of her father. Following a preview performance of the work in June 12, 1998, in Berlin, Ms. Schakowsky gave the definitive world premiere of Asanga on September 30, 1998, in Stockholm. The piece features an instrumentation that requirement of four low drums, including bass drum, and two higher tom-toms, plus two high middle plates or extremely high skins. Directions such as four low drums and a choice of either high middle plates or extremely high skins indicates that Volans intended to leave a portion of the instrument selection up to the performer. This is a departure from the very specific instrumentation required for She Who Sleeps. However, Asanga's instrument directions are more in line with part one of Akrodha. Both pieces give the prospective performer some leeway in selecting his or her instruments from a given performance. Asanga contains the four structural tempos, as shown here. And consequently, this graph shows the flow of tempos in Asanga. We start at 116, then 160, back to 116, then 160 again, 116 again, to a range of 152 to 160, 200, and finally 116, which is the coda of the piece. This produces the following temporal form of Asanga. In terms of motivic content and overall musical material, Asanga bears more similarities to Akrodha, part one. The opening portion of Tempo A's first appearance, measures 1 through 32, features an interaction of three short motifs. Volans treats the opening motifs in the same way he treats Tempo A of Akrodha, the first part, in part one, in that he swirls and mixes the motifs with each other. Asanga has its own section of frequently reappearing sequences. Asanga's sequences are grouped on a much smaller scale than Akrodha, in that Volans will maintain sequences made up of two or three patterns, rather than a full reappearances work. Asanga has many more similar motivic approaches to Akrodha than She Who Sleeps with a Small Blanket, as shown by the ways Volans applies the motifs within the structural templates. In addition, certain motifs transcend their original temporal home and become integrated into other structural tempos, or at times even go so far as to wholly become the material of that different tempo. The sequence layering of motifs one after another creates a straightforward effect that causes the pieces to simply go up in energy all the time until reaching the coda. Let's now talk about performance practices for Akrodha. Part one for Akrodha requires 9 drums, 2 of which must have wooden heads, and 5 bass drums. In terms of instrument selection, the notes on instrumentation in the score lead the selection of certain instruments in part one up to the performer. Volans does not specifically mention which drums the performer should use in part one. In fact, he merely states that the 9 drums, minus the 2 wooden-headed drums, should range from tom-toms through congas to high bongos. For my performance of Akrodha, I wanted to select instruments that reflected this range as best as possible. The 3 different timbres of tom-toms, congas, and bongos presented a challenge for how to equally represent the instruments, yet somehow make the upper staff as a whole as one entity. I saw the conga as a halfway point in timbre between the tom-toms and bongos, and as a result, the conga acted as a perfect mediator. After much deliberation, I decided on the instrument combination of 3 tom-toms, assigned to drums 1, 2, and 4, 1 conga, assigned to drum 5, and 3 bongos, drums 7, 8, and 9. The 2 drums that are not mentioned, two numbers not mentioned, are reserved for the wooden-headed drums. I used what was called a compact conga, made by the company Latin Percussion, which is a portable model of a conga consisting of only the head and the rim. In addition to the benefits of having less instrumental weight to transport, the compact conga's depth, or lack thereof, better blended with the other 8 drums. The use of a regular conga would give it the deepest shell depth by far in the upper staff instruments. This would be odd, considering the drum to which it is assigned is the 4th highest drum in the upper staff, minus the wooden-headed drums. The score of part one suggested that the drums of the upper staff needed to be articulate, especially considering tempo A is written with many staccato notes. Although the conga and bongos are inherently articulate, the same could not be said for the tom-toms. To address this issue, I prepared the tom-toms by applying muffling devices in the form of moon gels to the heads. This fixed any potential lack of articulation in the tom-toms, as well as created further sonic unity with the conga and bongos. For the wooden-headed drum, I credit Professor Christopher Dean for helping me find a solution. He located special tom-toms with integrated wooden heads in an instrument storage room at the University of North Texas College of Music. These wooden drums provided the level of resonance I had been looking for, and I used them on my performance of Akrodha Part 1 in my 3rd doctoral recital. Unfortunately, the one hazard of using these wooden drums is that they would crack frequently due to the hours of intensive practice and preparation. Fixing them proved to be a challenge in that the heads were not removable from the shells, much less replaceable. Professor Dean helped me fix them by placing glue within the cracks that would occur over time. As an alternative, Robin Sikowski cut discs made of plywood to the size of drum head altogether and replaced it using a plywood disc. You replaced it with a plywood disc. This solution allowed for the desired resonance of the wooden toms I had used, while providing the option to effortlessly switch out the disc in the event of its cracking. Given the long duration of notes in part one, bass drums that could produce an open, succinct sound were needed. Bass drums 3 and 5 needed to be played with foot pedals, as the performance notes dictate. For those two, I used one drum set kick drum and one floor tom, which I converted to a bass drum using a conversion kit. The relatively smaller size of the converted floor tom expanded the pitch range of the bass drum voice as a whole. This image shows my setup for part one of Akrodha. I assembled the drums in the upper staff, similar to that of a chromatic keyboard. This approach fills in the gaps in between the instruments caused by logistical placements of drums and drum stands. In addition, it results in a setup with reduced width and ease of reach to every drum in the score. Furthermore, the chromatic approach automatically places the beating spots at approximate angles of 45 degrees to each other, thereby allowing the performer's hands to quickly maneuver up and down the drums with little to no need to cross the hands. Because measures 344 through 372 of part one involve the quick alternation between the two pedaled bass drums, I found it essential to place them on the same side of the setup and as close to each other as possible. To get the other three bass drums as close to the rest of the setup as possible, I suspended two of them and used legs to set the third up horizontally. When selecting my metals for part two, I took into account the metals used by Mr. Axelson, which were provided in the performance notes of the score, but the item was listed as well as the approximate pitch. For further direction, I relied on three guiding principles that Robin Schakowsky provided me during our conversations. The first was timbre. The individual timbre had to be satisfactory, but not conflict with the timbre of other metals in the respective palette of instruments, whether lying or suspended. The second was resonance. The metals had to ring, for Volans gives the stylistic direction of toujours laissez vibrer, or always let ring, in the very beginning of the movement. The third principle was controllability, as whatever instruments selected must be able to be physically controlled by the performer, as well as not interfere with each other logistically. These are the instruments and approximate pitches I selected for the lying staff. This involves a steel pipe, a steel beam, a cowbell, which is the LP Aspire model made by Latin Percussion, two brake drums, and two steel pipes of varying sizes and diameters. These are the instruments and approximate local pitches I selected for the suspended staff. They involve two metal plates, a one metal pan 9 inches in diameter, a metal plate, one mambo cowbell, again made by Latin Percussion, and two unglocken notes, presenting pitches of B flat and F sharp. This is my setup for part two. Notice that I use the idea of the double keyboard, as I mentioned earlier, with the lying staffs below and the upper instruments written above. For the lying instruments, the connected surface of a table allowed me to move the instruments as close to each other as possible, resulting in efficiency of movement from instrument to instrument in performance. I laid two long tubes of window insulation on top of the table parallel to each other, which resulted in the metal's resonance not being infringed upon. The suspended instruments were mounted onto a constructed rack made of galvanized pipe. I used galvanized pipe to hang the metals to prevent the rack from collapsing under their weight. Pipes made of PVC was just not an option. I used a combination of strong fishing line and duct tape in order to completely customize the distance from metal to metal, rather than be tied to preset hooks, as seen in other racks used in percussion settings. Three different sets of implements are needed to perform part one: felt, wood, and harder sticks. Certain measures in part one require very fast transitions from felt to wood and vice versa. The best solution to these fast changes was to use the same implement for both the felt and wood passages, more specifically a swizzle drumstick. I settled on using the Vic Firth Terry Bozzio signature swizzle drumsticks, officially entitled the Phase 2 model, pictured to the left. The felt side of this implement was provided a soft yet articulate sound that I was looking for. Unfortunately, this drumstick model is discontinued and no longer in production. However, an excellent alternative would be to use a general pair of drumsticks and wrap layers of moleskin around the butt ends of the sticks. This emulates the sound of that articulate felt that provides the necessary contrast to the wood timbre. The direction for harder sticks first appears after an extended passage that uses the felt mallets. With this evidence, I inferred that the term harder is relative to the felt in this situation. I selected an implement that could act as a medium between the other two timbres. That selection was rubber. I decided on the ENS360, a model in the ensemble series made by Innovative Percussion. These mallets produce a warm, articulate sound that serves as an excellent mediator between the felt and wood spectrums. Part two requires an implement with enough hardness to produce a full tone on the metals. At the same time, however, there are multiple instances where the lying step and the suspended step have considerable dynamic contrast that occur simultaneously. Rubber, plastic, metallic, and other unwound mallets have the ability to produce the desired full sound, but their monotonality creates an extra level of difficulty to control the necessary dynamic contrast. Therefore, the ideal implement must exhibit an element of multitonality that gives the performer additional control at softer dynamic levels. I found this multitonality in certain yarn and cord mallets, such as those designed for marimba and vibraphone. I selected the Vic Firth M33 Terry Gibbs keyboard mallets, the hardest model in Mr. Gibbs' signature line of vibraphone and marimba mallets. They gave me the ability to fully project the metallic instruments without the need to overexert physically, while simultaneously play piano and pianissimo dynamics in the movement with relative ease. When performing Akrodha, the tempos and tempo relationships of the pieces are crucial. According to Volans, performing one of his multiple percussion works in the wrong tempo is tantamount to playing in the wrong key. In addition, performing with incorrect tempo relationships destroys the structure. The performer should stop the written accent in intentional, should look at each accent as written and not unwritten, meaning the performer should not include any implied accents or any accents of his or her own. Grace notes should be played with a degree of openness in between the grace note and the primary note, and not closed like a flam. Dr. Volans wrote his multiple percussion solos melodically, meaning he wrote the drum patterns as diatonic tunes on the piano, rather than rhythmically. In Akrodha, each structural tempo contains one or more individual motifs that have different aesthetics. It is important to consistently interpret each motif and its subsequent reappearances, varied or otherwise, with a level of uniqueness and nuance exclusive to that motif. This interpretive method is more difficult to apply to part two, as the motifs operate more independently of the structural tempos. The melody involves repetition of fragments, as mentioned in part two's motivic analysis, but isolated incidences of reappearances do take place. When these micro reappearances occur, whether as a reiteration, variation, or transposition, they should be made known. Although extraneous accents are not appropriate in Akrodha or any of Dr. Volans' multiple percussion works, agogic accents can help to convey the intentions of the music. In certain passages, notes are grouped in ways that are, for the lack of a better term, unorthodox for the meters in which they are written. Such a passage is measure 71 through 76 of tempo A, seen here. It is important for the performer to pay attention to groupings such as these and to not let the pitches of the drums or preconceived conventional groupings of compound meters become distractions. In part two, a substantial amount of material written within the staffs of the movement is written in sequences of the same rhythm. The first nine measures of the movement have multiple examples of this. With measures such as these, the performer should be less concerned with placing the rhythms within a metrical context and more with the sequences themselves. Conversely, there are measures of part two where rhythmic sequences contain a variety of rhythms, such as measures 36 through 42. More attention should be given to how they are placed within the meter in these instances. The biggest obstacle with successfully performing both movements of Akrodha is achieving the exact written tempos and tempo relationships. The material at brighter tempos is very fast and quick, but with considerable practice, performing these sections at the intended tempos is doable. However, there are two measures in part one that are impossible to execute with the proposed setup, measures 297 and 319, and a reiteration of 319 that occurs at measure 362. All these are part of the tempo E structural tempo, 168 beats per minute. The and of two in measure 297 and beat three of measures 319 and 362 require mallet intervals that are unobtainable with the setup I use. For the performance, I use three mallets rather than just two because the music necessitated it. But even with four mallets, I wasn't able to achieve these measures. I spent a considerable amount of time deciding which pitches would be best to eliminate. The bass drum pitch was already ruled out because it was needed to keep the ostinato intact. That left me with two pitches in each of the measures. The deciding factor was that in both clusters, one of the upper staff pitches had already appeared in their respective measures, while the others were new pitches in these measures. For measure 297, the reappearing pitch was the treble middle C, and for measure 319, and later measure 362, it was the treble D pitch. Therefore, I ultimately decided to omit the reappearing pitches to avoid omitting new material. So let us summarize what we have talked about this evening. The overall forms of Kevin Volans' multiple percussion solos are governed by tempo. The different tempos and their relations to each other determine the piece's structures and directions. Supporting these tempos is the motivic content. As it can be seen with Akrodha, the motifs act as characteristic traits for the tempos. When one tempo is presented or represented, its signature motivic content is likely to be heard. Though this was more often the case in part one than in part two, characteristics do exist in both movements, albeit at different levels of intensity. The motifs and their subsequent variations seen throughout the work add an additional layer of tangibility to the structural tempos. In Akrodha, the tempo is much more than a number or even a style of direction. The motifs demonstrate that concept. Comparative analyses of She Who Sleeps with a Small Blanket and Asanga although the exact implementation of the motifs vary from piece to piece. Nevertheless, structural tempos and their supporting motifs do serve varying degrees of vitality in each work. The vastness of Akrodha as a piece and as a setup meant that considerations and methods for approaching it needed to be discussed. The management of 28 different instruments with a portion of their selection left to the performer's discretion can be a daunting task. Therefore, the performance practices of Akrodha intended to provide the performer enough of a concrete starting point to undertake the piece both musically and logistically. Furthermore, it demonstrated how a prospective performer should approach the piece in accordance with Volans' intent and how to better convey the structural tempos to the listener through the motivic content. At the same time, portions of the performance practices were deliberately passive. The dynamic of allowing performers to partly choose his or her own instruments for the piece indicate that not only are different individual performances of Akrodha with different instruments and setups encouraged, but mandated. Though some approaches are universal, the nuances identified when comparing individual performances of Akrodha will play a primary role in helping the performer develop his or her own stylistic expression of this work. With this, I come to the end of my lecture of a motivic analysis and performance practices for Akrodha by Kevin Volans, including comparative analyses of Volans' other multiple percussion solos, She Who Sleeps with a Small Blanket, and Asanga. This presentation would not have been possible were it not for a collective of supportive individuals. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Kevin Volans, Robin Schakowsky, and Johnny Axelson for taking the time to contribute to my research and for being so supportive every step of the way. Next, I would like to thank my advisory committee, Professor Mark Ford, Professor Christopher Dean, and Professor Eugene Guillaro-Corpron. Their unwavering support, understanding, and patience have helped me to grow professionally as well as personally. Thirdly, I would like to thank the vast array of wonderful teachers I have had the honor of studying percussion under during my tenure at the University of North Texas. In addition to Professors Ford and Dean, they include Professors Paul Rennick, Edward Soap, Michael Drake, Jose Aponte, and Edward Smith. Their guidance and high performance standards are things that I will carry with me for the rest of my life. Additionally, I wish to thank my fellow students, some of whom I have performed alongside, and some of whom I taught in some capacity. I am truly grateful for all I have learned from them and for their friendship. Last and certainly not least, I would like to thank my mother and father, as well as our cat, Mamie, for always believing in me. Their unconditional love and support were what kept me going through the thick and thin of this research and resulting dissertation and lecture.